C.S. Lewis, J.R.R. Tolkien, and Susan Cooper, among the best fantasy writers for children. And I am sitting down in the studio today with Susan Cooper, author of The Dark is Rising. That's coming up next on Books Alive. Thank you so much for joining us today on Books Alive. I have to tell you that today is a dream come true. I am sitting here in the studio with one of the premier fantasy writers for children of all times. Her name is Susan Cooper. Thank you so much for being here with us.
Thank you for having me.
This is just fantastic. Okay, now for anybody who didn't grow up reading her, this is the lady who wrote the series called The Dark is Rising, those five books, for which she won a Newbery Award and a Newbery Honor. But let's get a little sense of who she is and how she got here. You are not American born. You grew up in London proper, or?
I'm English, clearly.
English?
I grew up in Buckinghamshire, which is 20 miles west of London.
Okay.
During World War II, so it was very noisy.
Yes.
And I don't know how detailed to get. Worked as a journalist in London. Came to America, met an American whom I married, to my editor's horror, and came over here in the 60s.
Okay.
And I've been here ever since.
Now, when you were, Buckinghamshire, when the bombs were dropping in World War II, or were you actually living in London?
We weren't far enough out of London to be evacuated, which is what happened to a lot of children. They were sent away from the cities. But we had the main railway line to the west at the end of our road, and the planes were always trying to hit it. So we spent a lot of time in the air raid shelter.
Yes. And that gave you your sense of the dark and the light.
Yeah, when you're sitting there and your mother is reading to you by candlelight and the candle flame goes every time a bomb comes down.
Wow.
You know, we took it for granted, but you do grow up with this sense of the bad guys and the good guys, obviously.
Yeah.
So I think that shadow is at the back of your head.
Okay. Now, you were a big reader as a child, would you say?
Oh, yes, I was one of those children, like my grandchildren are now, happily, like a vacuum cleaner.
Oh, good.
Except that there weren't that many children's books.
Right.
Then, we're talking just World War II and just after it. So you read whatever there was.
What did you read?
The generation before us was E. Nesbitt, so we must have read those books. I remember two books by the poet John Masefield, The Box of Delights and The Midnight Folk, which are fantasies.
Wow.
But my favorite books weren't fantasies at all. They were by Arthur Ransome, who wrote a series of books about kids messing about in boats.
Oh, that's great. All right, now I know you went to school and you got into the journalism pretty early, right? As a student?
I went to Oxford and read English. The syllabus stopped at 1832.
Wow.
So we did an awful lot of early.
Yeah.
From Beowulf to Malory. Largely that was the influence of two lecturers. Called Tolkien and C.S. Lewis.
Yes, she just said Tolkien and C.S. Lewis. They were her professors at Oxford, yes.
I never met them.
You never met them?
We used to go to Tolkien's lectures on Beowulf. And he mumbled rather. and C.S. Lewis was a wonderful booming lecturer on Renaissance literature.
Wow.
He was great.
Wow. Did you enjoy reading that early literature? Was that, I mean, is that what, like, you know, meat and potatoes for
yes,
you?
Yes, yes, okay. Especially the Arthurian.
All right, so then you fell in love with this professor at MIT.
Then I came to the States.
And you came here. And you did not think this place was so great, or I know that you were very homesick.
Well, I was 27, Nicholas was 46, mm-hmm. and had three teenage children.
Wow. So
it was not like anything I had ever been through before.
Yeah.
And I was homesick.
Oh.
But I had two babies between 18 months of each other. I'd written two books before I left Britain. I'd written science fiction. It was published as science fiction. I didn't think it was.
Wow.
A fantasy called Mandrake, which was for adults. And a book called Oversea Under Stone, which was... I thought it was just a standalone fantasy, but it was sort of slightly open-ended because I didn't want to feel I'd never meet the people again. And jump ahead 10 years, mm-hmm. And here I am in America, reading an awful lot of stuff I now realize, looking at my bookshelves, mm-hmm. about early Britain. And I had an idea one day for a book about a boy waking up on his 11th birthday and finding he could work magic. And I knew it was going to be set in deep snow of the kind that we have in Massachusetts, mm-hmm. But in England, mm-hmm. where you never, hardly ever get snow like mm-hmm. that. Mm-hmm. And when I started thinking about writing that book, I think I'd just reread Oversea Under Stone for some reason. And I suddenly thought, that book is going to link with this new one. A character called Merriman, who was in the first book, is going to be in this book. Wait a minute, I thought, there are going to be five books.
Wow.
And I took a piece of paper and wrote down five titles, starting with the one that was already written. And who was going to be in each book, the times of the year, and the place they were going to be set. And oh, yes, and I wrote the last half page of the last book.
Oh, my gosh.
And put it away and began writing the next book. And then went on for 6 years to write the whole bunch. I do envy people who write series because they know where they're going.
So you had the beginning and you had the end, but you had no idea what was going to happen in the middle.
Very little. I knew the rough theme of each of the five
mm-hmm,
books.
Mm-hmm.
It's a voyage of discovery every time, I think, for the writer as much as the reader. At least I know the beginning and the end of each individual book. But a lot of the middle is, it's a journey and you meet people that you might not have expected to meet, which is lovely.
All right, so this is book one. This is Oversea Under Stone. And this is the one that she wrote first and then came back to write the rest years later. How did you meet Simon, Jane, and Barney?
I've no idea. I just...
Really?
I was a reporter, and I had written a few things for the Sunday Times I was working for. And the literary editor came in one day with a piece of paper and said, you ought to try this. And it was a competition from an English publishing house for a family adventure story. And they were offering £1,000, which was more than I earned in a year. So I tried. And for some reason, just thought of these three kids. Where do their names come from? Who knows?
Thought of these three kids. Okay.
The children always say to you, where do you get your ideas?
Right.
And you have no idea.
Yes. So when you go, do you type? Do you write freehand? What is your process like?
I have a room at the top of the house with no computer and no telephone. And I go up there with a hardback notebook and write with a pen on the right-hand page. and talk to myself a little on the left-hand page. Not very intelligent talking, just like, go check that. Or and then after that, usually that's in the morning, and then in the afternoon I will go to the computer and put that into the computer, and one hopes make it better.
Okay. So you're editing yourself as you go along. Well, if you haven't begun this wonderful journey, Simon and Jane and Barney are going to be, it's Cornwall, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. They're going to be roaming around an old house on their summer vacation, I think it was, and they discover a manuscript that's really old, and it's going to lead them, it's going to open a door to a journey that's going to take them into the world of a huge battle of the dark and the light. And in this book, that manuscript is going to give them clues to find a grail. And I know if I say grail, you guys are all thinking holy grail. So you're going to have to explain for me if this is a grail or the grail.
It's not the grail. It's okay. Not the holy grail. It's a grail, a chalice, grail. Really, okay. Is what it is.
All right. All right. Which has wonderful runes on it that are going to then give them more information. But what she does here is she conjures up that whole forceful feeling of good versus evil and the dark versus the light. And all right, do you write for children?
No, I write for me.
Okay.
It's what Marie Sendak used to call my child self.
Ah. You know,
that echo of the, what age? Maybe 10, maybe 11.
Uh-huh.
No, maybe earlier. That is in the back of your imagination.
Okay.
I once collected quotes from 20 children's authors saying exactly the same thing. I write for myself.
Wow.
Obviously, if you're writing a picture book,
mm-hmm.
Then you need to be conscious of your audience.
Mm-hmm.
But I don't write for children. I think if you are deliberately doing that, there's a danger that you're going to write down.
Yes.
And no.
And not respect.
I'm writing for contemporaries.
Yes, yes. Wow. Okay, so what happens to you when you're reading this is that instead of just being aware of the things that kind of go wrong in the day-to-day world around you, you take a step back and you start to get that bigger perception of, you know, just the forces in the world. And it does connect you with a very deep part of yourself. And you describe
of all
it,
of us.
Yes.
You know. I mean, I wouldn't describe myself as religious in any way. I'm in no way connected to organized religion, but I was raised Anglican, Episcopal, mm-hmm. in American terms.
Mm-hmm.
And also reading a great deal of myth and legend is going to give you a great sense of good and evil. But the older you get, the more you realize that that's what we are. We are a mixture of both those things. And our life is the course we choose between the two of them.
Ah.
And if we're not saying anything to kids deliberately,
mm-hmm.
but you rather hope that that sense will come out of the books.
Mm-hmm. You know? You evoke it.
Well, one hopes.
But. One does. You do. No question. All right. Then she went and wrote book two of the series. This book is called The Dark is Rising, as the whole series is called The Dark is Rising. Now, for this, you won the Newbery Honor. Do you remember where you were when you got the call that you had received the Newbery Honor?
We have a little house, a holiday house in the British Virgin Islands,
uh-huh.
on an island a long way from anywhere. I did a lot of writing down there because my husband was a professor, so we had the long academic summers. The kids and I used to go down there.
Mm-hmm.
Anyway, we're down there and we have no telephone because this is a long time ago and it's very primitive. And a little boat comes across from the next island where there is a telephone, a little hotel island. And they say, Susan, telephone call. So I get in my little boat and I go across.
Oh, my gosh.
And somebody on the telephone is very excited, and she says that this is the American Library Association, and she wants to tell me that The Dark is Rising is a Newbery honor book. And I'd never heard of the Newbery Medal. I was this ignorant immigrant.
You're just writing.
I said, thank you very much. And I went back in my little boat to the island, and I said, they just called me to tell me my book missed winning some prize.
Oh, no.
Then my editor called, another trip in the boat.
Oh, no.
And told me the facts of life.
Who was your editor?
Margaret McElderry.
Oh, my gosh.
She was a legend.
A legend, yeah. Absolutely. Wow, that's amazing. Well, so in this book, we meet an entirely new character from Simon, Barney, and Jane. We meet Will Stanton. And Will is turning 11. Now, that seems to be a real pivotal age when you're writing in children's lives. Is that a feeling that you have, or is that just something that's just randomly happens?
They all tend to be that age. It's just before puberty. Mm-hmm. It's just before we all get obsessed with the other sex, you know, and that takes over our subconscious as well as our conscious.
Mm.
So I think that's why, because I'm not writing about boy-girl relationships. Mm-hmm. I'm writing about everything that leads up to that.
Mm-hmm.
And if I were writing about kids 2 years older, then mm-hmm. then you'd be writing completely different.
A very different
consciousness.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. Now Will is turning 11, but his whole life is about to just absolutely turn upside down, and you reveal to him that he is the last of the old ones.
Yep.
What is an old one?
If you are saying there are two powers, each of which would like to be the dominant one in human life, the light and the dark,
mm-hmm.
The old ones in these books are immortal leaders of the light all around the world, who are trying to stop the dark from rising.
Okay. Are you one?
I am a storyteller.
I'm not letting you get away with that. Do you feel like one?
No, of course not.
Are you kidding me? Really? Okay. All right. Because there is such a feeling when you're reading this and you read about the old ones, it's like something you could reach out and you want to be able to touch an old one. You just have a sense they're there, but you've never seen one, you've never met one that you know of, you know, that kind of thing. But it's like it resonates with some place inside of you. Did you feel that when you wrote it?
Well, if we're all a mixture of good and evil, then presumably it's the good side in the writer and the reader that with whom it resonates. You know?
Mm-hmm. Okay.
That's not a very good answer, but it's the best I can discover.
All right. When you wrote this, did you feel like you were remembering something you'd forgotten?
The way you do when you're reading myth. I suppose that kind of frame takes hold of you. You know, old Tolkien used to say that there are no new stories. There is a cauldron of story.
Mm-hmm.
There is this big pot
mm-hmm.
In which are all the stories that have ever been told.
Mm-hmm.
And that we all dip into it. And our story is what we make of whatever piece we take out.
Hmm.
Now the memories, the subconscious, racial almost memories that are in the stuff in that cauldron
mm-hmm.
are also hovering somewhere in your unconscious, I think. So to that extent, you feel you're tapping into something you've always known.
And I've read that you feel that we sort of all hold all of the memories. Am I saying that right? Is that what you intended to convey?
You mean like the Jungian subconscious?
I don't know about that. But you're going to have to make it easier than that for me.
I think there are all sorts of echoes within the collective subconscious of the human race that we couldn't really put into words. But I mean, we're all the same kind of animal.
Well, except that even you say that it's the responsibility of the librarian to match the child to the book. And they're not all going to be the same. You know, we look at the bookcase behind you, and there are going to be certain books there that resonate with this child, some different ones for that child. So, you know, you're talking about a collective unconscious memory of all of the feelings and the happenings that are somewhere in there, but, you know, but to match a child up to a book, you know, I can't give the same book to the 4 10-year-old boys that walk
into
my library.
Well, this is why librarians are so wonderful, because and English teachers, they can sense, and they know from observation which kid and which book are going to be soulmates.
Go together. Yes, exactly.
God bless them. What would we do without them?
Well, we need to shout that from the rooftops at this point, you know? We truly do. Okay, so our friend Will Stanton is the last of the old ones. In Oversea Under Stone, Merriman Lyon is the first of the old ones. And you've got these old ones all around the world. But as Will turns 11, all kinds of things are going to start happening to him, including time shifts. So what is time for you? How do you experience time?
It's an ocean, and we are a little boat on the river going down to the ocean. If you grew up in England, which has thousands of years of human occupation, you have time going in all directions around you. I mean, you have, we used to have a grassy mound not very far away, which was an Iron Age fort. And Windsor Castle, which is 900 years old, was on the horizon. And a farmer was ploughing once when I was a kid and came across a Roman mosaic pavement. I mean, England was Roman for 400 years. So this sense of echoes, I think, stays with you.
Do you ever experience them all? You had a quote about merging each half, the two halves of a breath. Merging. And in that moment, the 4th century and 20th century came together as one. So it was like time just merged in that moment.
That in there?
Nope, it's in one of the other ones. It might be in here, actually.
Well, it's that sort of thing.
I love it. And I mean, when I read that, I just thought, my gosh, what is time for her? This is amazing.
It's a mystery. And in the end, everything about us is a mystery.
It's a mystery. You know? Okay.
And absolute certainties about what we are like or what things should be like are extremely perilous. Which I think I write about that all the time without really shouting it.
I've got two questions I want to ask you right now, and I don't want to forget them. One is about, you know, you're talking about the layers of time in England and the fact that myth resonates with us so deeply, and how the United States is such a young country and we don't have our deep myths like you have the Welsh myth, you know, And what that does to our collective unconscious or our collective psyche, that as a people, that, you know, we only go back to, like, you know, 1607 when the first English settlement.
Not all of you.
Not all of us?
Not all of you. I mean, for thousands of years, American Indians were.
Yes.
This was their home, still their home. And there are an awful lot of stories. Each tribe has its stories.
Mm-hmm.
So the continent is not without its echoes.
Yes, you're right. The continent has its echoes. But we don't carry those forward. We let them go through the sieve, those stories.
Well, they belong to their own people.
Mm-hmm.
And this is really what Ghost Talk, the last book I've done, is sort of about. That the stories that came with the white settlers to America sort of took, I can't think of the right image, took over to an extent, and any race that is subject to another race is going to be very protective of its own stories, of its own identity. And so there hasn't been a... England is so very old that the different races that got subjugated by succeeding races eventually have merged into a sort of collection, though some Welsh nationalists wouldn't say that they were, which hasn't had a chance to happen in this country.
Mm-hmm. So you think when we
do... I'm not saying this very well, but...
Well, when we do... So we're still sort of our separate little...
You need another 1,000 years or so.
And then what will happen?
Well, then you will end up like the kind of mongrel that I am, you know.
Which gives you what? In terms of myth?
It simply makes it all more layered.
Layered, okay.
No.
All right. So, okay. Now, let me ask you this one. I went to T.A. Barron, an author, and I was telling you this before we sat down, to ask him what he would want to ask you if he were here, because he also writes fantasy and he writes about Merlin. And one of your characters, Merryman, if you squish his name all together, he becomes Merlin. So here's the question. Your books have a seamless connection between a magical alternate reality and our current everyday reality. Do you believe that is actually how the universe is? Is there always a merging, even if we don't always see it, between magical reality and perceived reality?
I don't know the answer to that question. It's
okay.
Extremely complicated.
Yes. Well, let's...
She said she was going to spring this on me.
Yes, I did. Well, let me ask you this.
Alternate reality, meaning...
Well, how about where Merryman is going to go to when he leaves? Where does he go? He goes somewhere. Where does the lady come from? Where are the sleepers waiting? Where do the old ones really reside, that they get their wisdom and they hold on to it and they're immortal? That whole world that they inhabit, is that existing at the same time you and I are talking?
This is where the word mystery comes into play. It's not like making a piece of clockwork.
Yes.
You know, you haven't got little details that you can say, look, this is how it works.
Right. So we suspend all of that logic and we just go...
It's like going out at night and looking at the stars. You know, what do you know about what's up there?
Mm-hmm.
You can see it.
Mm-hmm.
You can write about it. But you can't explain it.
Ah, so it is a mystery. And we just hold on to that mystery.
Yep.
Yep. Okay. All right. Good answer. All right. Now, do you want to say anything else?
No, I was just thinking that when you go out at night and there is that sky, the sun comes up and you think it's a different day, is different from night, but they're still there.
Yes, they are. Ooh, that's wonderful. That's wonderful. Wow. because for me that instantly becomes a metaphor for the forces of the light being present even though they're beyond our glimpse. And the forces
of
the dark too.
Yeah.
Yes.
And
yes.
always will be.
Yeah. Yeah. But it's there. Yeah. See, I want to know how you, I mean, let's face it. You're not writing a story about three kids in a school who, you know, want to spy on the teachers in the teacher's lounge. You know, you're not writing a story about, you know, kids who, you know, want to pull each other's underwear down or something. You know, you're writing about these incredibly powerful, really feelings and senses that we have. And I just experience your writing as though you're translating into these things called words, these realities that we all experience but can't touch and can't explain. And I just want to know what that's like to be you and do that.
It comes from deep down and a long way away and a long time ago. And it's always been there and it's never going to change. I'm really not saying this very well. But it is, they are, it's the light and the dark, they are eternals. So we are, it's going back to Tolkien's Cauldron of Story, mm-hmm. you know, we are simply plugging into the big questions, the long stories.
Mm-hmm. Do you think there's another dimension where these things exist and we come from there, and so we kind of have a sense that we have a memory of it, but because we're in this dimension, we can't access that memory?
Well, we are in linear time, and because we are born and we die,
mm-hmm.
We can't conceive of anything else like that.
Mm-hmm.
And the physicists and the astrophysicists try to explain us, but we can't really explain. I keep going back to this word mystery.
Mm-hmm. Which is fair.
That's the wonderful thing about writing for people below the age of 21 is that the sense of mystery
uh-huh.
is still there.
Yeah. Well, I think we hang on to it, we hold it, we don't pay all that much attention to it, but I think we hold on to it because at my age, to read these books is to just feel as though you're awakening something that's been there, and I'm like, oh, yes, yes, I know that.
That's what we hope we do. That's
yes,
nice.
Yes, I know that, it's in there. Okay, I have a book here of yours, and it's called Dreams and Wishes. And these are her essays on writing for children. And are these some of your speeches, actually?
Yes, yeah. And a lot of them, there is a wonderful thing called the Children's Literature New England,
mm-hmm.
which was a kind of floating conference every year.
Mm.
And a lot of us used to go to it every year. And I think the best talks in there are the ones that I wrote for CLNE.
Well, this is a phenomenal book, and if you really want to get a sense of how she thinks, you know, about myth and our culture and what we don't have in terms of kind of the layers of time and what we seek because we don't have all of that. You know, we seek ritual. You were talking about that in one of your speeches, and even our Sunday football games are rites. And nubile young women, you know, and cheerleaders on the sidelines and things like that.
Everybody needs ritual.
That's right. Everybody needs it. That's what we're doing. You talk here about Joseph Campbell talking about myth. And his great complaint is that we live today in a demythologized world, a society without the guidelines of ritual, a society which lacks the unconscious awareness of long-established patterns of civilized behavior.
Well, do we?
I think we do. At least over in this neck of the woods, we seem to. You guys over in England. Well, do you feel American now?
I'm an American citizen.
But do you feel like an American?
Yes, I feel like an American because America is made up of people like me who came and missed the place they came from.
Ah, that's neat. Whoops. Okay.
And that lack of ritual is what my friend John Langstaff felt, singer, director, who founded something called the Christmas Revels, which is still done at Christmas time in 9 cities.
Hmm.
And it was a compilation of words and song and dance, which became its own ritual, you know, for Christmas. That's irrelevant, but sort of related.
Okay, cool. All right, now she lives in a salt marsh. Is it an island?
You make me sound like a frog.
No, I make you sound like a thinking person who loves nature, surrounds herself by nature because she gets a lot from being in nature. Is that true?
Yes, I think so.
Okay.
I fell in love. I built a house on an island in a salt marsh on the south shore of Massachusetts in order to be close to my children and my grandchildren who mm-hmm. live nearby.
Mm-hmm.
But living there with windows all the way around the house and looking out at the sea when the tide comes in
mm-hmm.
and the changing salt marsh when the tide is out, it gave me a sense not just of the birds and the creatures in the grass, but of course of the people who were there on that land
mm-hmm.
for thousands of years
mm-hmm.
hunting. Maybe this is in my consciousness so much, this book I've just done, that I keep coming back to it.
This is Ghost Talk, her brand new, and it comes out, is it October?
No, it's out.
It came out. Oh, it's out now?
End of August, I think.
Okay. This is really in the Puritan times in New England.
Yes, it was a result of thinking about the place where I live and the people who were on it. And then I know what I did, first of all. I went to the local history just to look up the history of the place I was, literally the place, the piece of land I was on. And it had been deeded to an Englishman 400 years ago by the Plymouth Colony Court. He was a cooper by trade, and one of the old maps, it was called Cooper's Island, and I thought, ooh! It wasn't his place. It isn't my place. For such a long time, the people who lived on it, hunted across it, never thought of land as belonging to anybody. They simply lived with it. And when you have that feeling clashing suddenly with a culture that says you can own land, what happened? And I went back, it took me years, I went back to all the old sources, the early Puritan writings. You can't ask anybody, nobody's got an eyewitness account to give you what happened 400 years ago. And because I am a storyteller, within the historical background, I found my imagination giving me a story, giving me an American Indian boy and an English settler boy. And the book is really the extremely dangerous friendship between these two and the appalling things that happened, because you have the first Thanksgiving feast with the white settlers eating gratefully with the Indians who've helped them. And within 60 years, you've got both sides at each other's throats in King Philip's War, which kills 600 settlers and more than 3,000 American Indians. I just wanted to put my two boys into this situation. Crossing that piece of time and try to say, this must be how it happened. Can we avoid people behaving this way?
Mm, I wondered
can
about
we?
That.
Mm-hmm. Can we? Mm-hmm. I had to cling, well, not cling, I had to fit my imagined story into an accurate historical background, mm-hmm. Which took a long time. Because
how did you research the Indian culture?
You can only read, nothing was written down. Mm-hmm. You can only read what was written by everybody, anybody, in both cultures, then and since then. Mm-hmm. You know, I mean, I went through all Roger Williams' letters. Mm. Roger Williams, the sort of renegade Puritan who founded Rhode Island. All the way up to, I have two enormous volumes called Native Writings in Massachusetts.
Wow.
Those are just historical details. They don't help with trying to understand mm-hmm. what happened. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. You do all the research you possibly can, and mm-hmm. then you, with respect, put words into the mouths of one or two historical characters that you feel they might have said.
Why did you want to include Miles Standish, Roger Williams, the Massasoit?
Because they were there.
Okay. So you didn't just limit it to the experience of the boys themselves. You broadened our perspective so that we saw them within the context.
I don't think you can write, there's no point in writing it without the context.
Okay. Okay. All right. And then again, you know, I noticed, you know, in all of your books, this is Magician's Boy, which if you haven't found this for about, oh gosh, I would say 7 to 10-year-olds, even maybe a smart six could do it. Everything she writes, King of Shadows, I think that's in my pile over here, and the Boggart. Here's the King of Shadows. Here's the Boggart. This is humor. But there's always something imaginary. We have a ghost in this one talking to us.
I write fantasy. My imagination produces fantasy.
To it. Your imagination produces fantasy. Okay.
I can't control it.
Right. It's out of control. Okay. All right. Yeah, I was just, you know, I mean, It's a fantastic read. It's written in 4 parts, and you do get a whole different perspective on the early American history. It's not exactly written the way we learned it in the 4th and 7th grades. That's when I learned it in Virginia. So you make us look kind of bad here, I must say.
We were bad.
Okay. Did you feel some like it was us. Just a... Yeah, I was going to say, is it just some... Or did you get
it's always just some isn't
okay.
it?
You
know,
okay.
There would be no wars if it was all of us.
Okay. All right. So she's got a young boy. This opens up with his father in going out into a salt marsh, probably close to where you live, and finding a tree.
Don't give it away, Bob.
Okay. Finding a tree. And embedding a tomahawk. There. Well, he's going to make it a tomahawk. But one thing that you said there is that there was time in his father's time.
Well, our world is very swift.
What do we know?
You only have to go out from the big city into the countryside, mm-hmm. you know, and suddenly time is going more slowly.
Ah.
You know, time is relative mm-hmm. to mm-hmm. who you are and where you are.
The fast-paced life that we have in suburbia and in the cities, what do you think is being missed?
I don't know.
You don't know. Well, let's tease it for a minute, because you've got nature in your world, and it's very much a character in all of your books. Do you think our children are losing touch with that?
I worry about little screens and kids walking about looking at their little screens. I also worry about them sitting in classrooms everybody with a little screen in front of them and teacher with a screen. This new trend gives me great pause. But yes, I mean, it's a truism that we are all losing touch with nature. We shall have an even more obese population if our kids lose touch with playing outdoors because they're looking at their little screens. You cannot stop cultural shifts in things that are driven by technology, because that is, the river starts here and it goes on down there and you can't stop it. But we do need to stop and listen to the birds now and again, and look up at that sky. Mm-hmm. And
why?
And things. Because otherwise we will lose our capacity for contemplation, thought, and certainly for wonder.
So that's the answer to the question.
See, this is why you're a good interviewer.
I knew you had it. I knew you did. Thank you very, very much for that. That was wonderful, just wonderful. Okay, so this is Ghost Talk. This is the new one. At the end of this one, you talk about how it really comes down to one person and the action that one person has the courage, really, to take, because every one of your books has a character who has the courage to risk believing they have in them whatever it's going to take to do that, overcome that challenge that's just come up to them. And
that's at the very end of the last...
Oh, Silver,
is Silver on the
Tree?
Silver on the Tree there
somewhere? Yes. Yeah, I think you've got it.
No, it's a fatter one than that.
Is it this one? Yes.
What is it? Can I read you that bit?
Oh, you certainly may.
It's Merriman. I have to unwind the string and put my reading glasses on.
I'm getting out my tissue. She's going to read.
That's it. It's when he's... he says, Merriman, before he leaves, it is the end of the Darkest Rising sequence. They have achieved what they could achieve for the sake of the light. But he says to them, remember, it is altogether your world now, you and all the rest. We have delivered you from evil, but the evil that is inside men is at the last a matter for men to control. The responsibility and the hope and the promise are in your hands. Your hands and the children and the hands of the children of all men on this earth. The future cannot blame the present, just as the present cannot blame the past. The hope is always here, always alive, but only your fierce caring can fan it into a fire to warm the world. And the world will still be imperfect because men are imperfect. Good men will still be killed by bad, or sometimes by other good men. And there will still be pain and disease and famine, anger and hate. But if you work and care and are watchful, as we have tried to be for you, then in the long run, the worse will never, ever triumph over the better. And the gifts put into some men that shine as bright as Arias the sword shall light the dark corners of life for all the rest in so brave a world. It's individual responsibility, you know, which is all you can ask of any of us.
Mm-hmm. What did you do with your gifts? How did you meet that challenge?
I wrote stories.
Yeah? What kind of stories?
Well, we all write our own kind of stories. That's the only answer to that, really. It's the old prodigal son thing, you know, you've got a gift, use it.
What's your gift?
Writing stories.
Oh. Thank you for using your gift to write these magnificent stories.
Thank you for letting me talk.
You've given us wonder. You've found the words to describe wonder. You really have. You guys, I'm going down here.
Thank you, Bob.
Thank you all so much for joining us here today. It's been my real privilege to sit here and have this time to talk with the amazing Susan Cooper. And if you've got children at home who are aged, I would say 9 and up, even you, if it's the parents watching with us today, come over to the library and get yourself a copy, or go out to the bookstore, especially an independent bookstore, and get yourself a copy. Start with Oversea Under Stone, and again, you can really get a sense of how she thinks, and she explains herself really well in this Dreams and Wishes. So thank you so much for joining us, and thank you so much for being here today.
Thank you for letting me come.
Thanks so much for being here.